So, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sadie Tillery. I'm the Director of Programming at Full Frame, and welcome to our A&E Indie Film Speakeasy Conversation to be seen. We have a remarkable lineup of filmmakers here on the panel, and I really have to acknowledge Marco Williams as the sort of originator of the idea behind this discussion. Filmmakers are forced to make bold choices about what is seen and what is concealed in their filmmaking, and I feel like we have three films that have made powerful decisions in that regard represented. So I'd like to quickly introduce our panelists before I kick it off to our moderator, Robin Smith. Marco Williams is the director of The Undocumented, which will be screening today. Farihah Zaman is one of the co-directors of Remote Area Medical. And Martha Shane is one of the co-directors of After Tiller, both of which will also be screening today. And Robin Smith.
Hi, everybody. Thank you. It's nice to see people getting here at 12 o'clock. What we want to say is that panels can often be boring. And so we don't want this one to be boring. We know this is a topic that people are very opinionated about. And we want to be sure that you know we want you to ask tough questions, be thinking about that. We, together, are going to ask each other tough questions as well. The best thing that can happen is if we have a wonderful heated debate. There's plenty of moonshine back there. People want to loosen up a little bit. This is the speakeasy, so please feel free to partake if you want to. But let's get to it, because we have a lot to talk about today. So, Marco, each of these films, when you guys see them this afternoon, I hope you'll get a chance to see them, each of the filmmakers made different choices on what to show, what not to show. And Marco, I think yours is a great place to start, because you made a choice to show some pretty graphic bodies. So if you can explain to us how you made that decision, and at what point did you make the decision that that was going to be critical to the film?
Good afternoon. I don't know if anybody's read the description of what my film is about, but when I set out to make this film, a key component of it was how to present to the viewer exactly what was happening in southern Arizona, the number of migrants dying in the Arizona desert. And when I first approached the medical examiner, he was willing to let me film, but he said, I'll simply allow you to film skulls or bones. And I said to Dr. Parks, I said, you know, in all due respect, I think that nobody knows about your work and nobody's impacted by the work that you do, because you have elected to sanitize people's relationship to the tragedy that is occurring. So he and I had a kind of a very healthy back and forth, where I said, I think that if you allow me the opportunity to show all facets of what you do in terms of determining cause of death, working towards identification, in other words, give me full access to the morgue, give me full access to your forensic pathologists and their work, I think that the American audience will receive that and will be impacted by that. So I made a decision to film dead bodies.
Did you know at the time, yeah, the bodies in this film are, I don't want to give away too much, but it's extreme. Did you know when you asked that question really what you were asking? Did you know what they were going to look like?
Yeah, that's an appropriate question. So I'm going to take issue with extreme. I don't think that my depictions are extreme. I think that
unexpected, perhaps.
But as I will get on to say, and I don't want to predominate here, but if you film in a morgue, what do you expect to see? Dead bodies.
Right. Right.
So there's that's what goes on there. But you're absolutely right. I arrived to Arizona June 6th or 7th, and I got to the medical examiner's office, and they said, we have a fresh body. We were waiting for you to come. Are you ready to film? And no, I was not really ready to walk into a autopsy and record what transpired, but I was committed to this. So I did it, and I did it repeatedly throughout the summer. So yes, there was a kind of, you know, transition for me. You know, looking at the dead was not something I was familiar with, and certainly one might say that if you look at the dead through a camera lens, you're somewhat desensitized, perhaps. But again, it was all towards a very specific goal of, and I will, you know, share this. It was really towards a goal of humanizing those who have died and transcending the statistics. It's very easy to, in my film, if you come to see it, there are different ways in which the dead are recorded. They are recorded by writing on a wall in the Mexican consulate, where they write down the name of the person and some, you know, scribble. They're recorded in a pie chart by the medical examiner showing the increase in number of deaths. They're memorialized by crosses, but these are also people, and so how do you make sure that they're not simply statistics, but they are human beings? And so, arrogant on my part, perhaps, but a very conscious choice that, no, I'm going to show audiences that these are human beings.
So a question for each of you, and I think, Marco, one of the things in your film is it encourages the audience to really face the absolute truth of the policies of the American government down there and what's going on. And so let's go to you with remote area medical. Tell about your decision to show, because yours is very different. It's live people,
yes,
but you also use images and pictures to really force people to see an audience, to encourage them to understand what's really going on.
Yeah, and we actually had a similar goal to Marco in a way, in the sense of humanizing a topic that's often talked about in terms of numbers and statistics, which is healthcare. And we wanted to ask the question of, what is it actually like to live without insurance? What does that mean for your life, as opposed to how many people can we insure? What's the best policy? And we filmed a free pop-up medical clinic that took place in Bristol, Tennessee, almost exactly a year ago, actually. And the organization that puts on these clinics travel around and do most of their work in rural areas. So there's also an issue of access for a lot of people, and in addition to the financial strain of having to pay for healthcare, and people, you know, sleep in the parking lot overnight for many nights just to get free healthcare. They see about 2,000 people in 2 or 3 days. And what most people are hoping for when they show up at this clinic is dental work. I remember when my co-director, Jeff Reichert, and I first volunteered at a clinic before we filmed anything, one of the most visceral experiences for me was standing in the middle of this particular clinic was at in a high school, so standing in a high school gym and watching 50 dentists in rows of 10 by 5 all working at the same time. It was so different from how, you know, some of us have the privilege of receiving care, and it just hit me at that moment, like, this is what people have to go through. This is what happens when you are unable to receive dental care for decades. And so we did choose to include some pretty graphic footage of mostly people having teeth removed. I think
it will make you want to go to the dentist whenever you can.
Our editor went to the dentist twice while working on the film. He just like staring at an open mouth all day, you know.
So, but the specific image we're talking about bodies with Marco. The specific image we're talking about here is shots of a mouth where you are watching teeth be pulled out. And I will say, I watched it and screamed. But it proves an excellent point. I think more than anything that you showed in the film, it really shows you how desperate these people are. Mm-hmm. So did you know when you were filming, talk about your decision when you were filming it, to film it that close up, and when did the decision come to really show it?
The general decision to show it at all, we felt it was important from the beginning, because just that idea that, like, this is what happens when you don't get to go to the dentist for 15 years. The best thing that you hope for is to have all of your teeth pulled out. And that's such a shocking thing that, you know, in a country that has a lot of resources, that's what has to happen. What we did have a much longer debate about was exactly how much, what shots, when to pull away, how close. And, you know, there are decisions when you're making a film that you kind of stay firm on, where you're like, I know that it has to be this way, and not everyone's going to like it, and that's okay. But this was a situation in which we did actually do, we showed friends, we did repeated test screenings, because, you know, we started from this place of thinking, well, but this is what really happened, so you have to see the whole thing. But that's when you watch a film, you're being directed and focusing on that thing so much so that it's not really fair to just act as though, well, this is what happened, just, you know, just watch it. Yeah, so we wanted to be really careful about making sure that you should feel uncomfortable, but not crossing the line into being manipulative in some way by rubbing your face and how graphic and brutal it is.
And I think that's where we are. That's what this conversation is really about. Martha, let's go to you with After Tiller, Martha's film After Tiller. You made a decision not to show faces. And can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so our film is about four third trimester abortion doctors, and a lot of the film is these interactions between the doctors and the patients, either counseling or sometimes in the operating room. But we felt like it was really important from the beginning to put the decision in the patient's hands about whether or not they wanted to show their faces. You know, abortion, of course, is so stigmatized, particularly third trimester. And we knew that these women would have to go back to their communities and face people. And we knew that if this story was out there, it could really have a huge impact on their lives. But at the same time, we felt like out of respect for them, we should give them the opportunity to be totally open about it if that's what they wanted. And as you can see, and it's funny, interestingly enough, you know, a lot of people have said to us, it was such a great decision you made not to show any of the faces. And we were like, well, you know, that wasn't our decision, but thanks. You know, we're glad that it works effectively and that there's still a lot of emotional power to those interactions.
How would it have changed the impact of your film if one woman would have come forward and said, you know, these doctors mm-hmm. are taking a chance. I want to be completely open. I want my face to be seen. Would it have changed your film?
Yeah, well, actually, you know, there were women who did say that they wanted to have their faces in the film, and we filmed with a lot of them. As it turned out, it was the stories were more powerful from the women who had chosen not to show their faces. I think, you know, maybe because they, you know, they did feel more of the stigma, or maybe it was that they felt more protected and like they could be more honest. Without showing their faces. But for whatever reason, yeah, our best stories were all with the ones who didn't. And we actually, a couple times, we did a couple cuts where we had one story from a woman who showed her face. And it was actually really jarring to see a face after getting used to sort of the rhythm of these back and forths where you're seeing people's hands and feet, and you start to sort of really get all the emotion from just their little movements and stuff. It was really jarring to see the face of a patient. It felt like, why is this happening? So that was sort of an interesting discovery.
So is the decision not to show or to show something that you think about how it will impact your audience, how it will impact the film itself and the message that you as the filmmaker are trying to put out, or how the film will be seen? Will it be able to be broadcast? Will film festivals want to show this? Marco, if we can go back to you, maybe you can address sort of who are you, maybe all three.
I think this is, so if I knew then what I know now, would I have done something differently? And that is to the kind of somewhat long and arduous and torturous journey that I've been on with trying to have the film exhibited at festivals. And because of, you know, choices of words that people have used with in association with my film.
What are some of those words?
Well, explicit. And I, you know, so explicit, I had to run into the dictionary to see what explicit meant, because it sounded like a bad word. It sounded so pejorative. I think we think of explicit like explicit sex, you know. That's something that's a taboo and you're supposed to hide from it. Or, I'm sorry, not explicit, graphic. I was like, graphic, oh, that's terrible, I did something wrong. And even I smiled when I read the description in the program here at Full Frame, unvarnished. I thought, really? Unvarnished sounds rough and coarse, and had to look that up. And it, so yeah, I but would I do anything differently? Not at all. And that's something that I think is really very much part of this conversation, however, is that who gets to decide what is seen and what isn't seen. So I set out to make a film, make a choice, artistic choice. I make lots of choices to make this film. You know, I don't pay myself. I decide this is the movie I want to make. I don't want to do many interviews. I want to just show audiences. So I'm making all sorts of choices. They're mine. They may work. They may not work. But they're mine. And then to have the sort of arbiters of taste, the arbiters of commerce, the marketplace, and we'll start with festivals. It makes perfect sense. I understand them. It's hard to get a bunch of people to come in and look at a film with a bunch of dead bodies. It's not exactly a Sunday or Saturday afternoon, you know, thing that you want to do. So there is a kind of dilemma, and there's the need for a kind of partnership or a willingness or a recognition that these sets of choices are clearly made. They're not arbitrarily made. So no, I wouldn't do it again. I would love to have fist fights or arm wrestling with lots of festivals to kind of say to them, you know, you made a mistake. I'm sorry, I just want to add this one thing that I actually find that has happened with my film is how many people of a, I would call them a more liberal persuasion, will say to me or have said to me, it's so disrespectful what you've done. And I want to say, like, who the fuck are you to decide what's respectful or not for them? Why do you just get to decide that it's disrespectful for Mexican families or Latin American families? You know, particularly in a film where I have met families that have given me permission to share their story. So I do find that the currency or the exchange happens from the moment you start making the film. Is a funder going to give you money if they, you know, truly understand what your intentions are? And then once you make the film, are festivals going to embrace it? Are they going to figure out a way to present it, to help audiences be, you know, welcomed? And what do you do if you are hoping to get broadcast? And I'm happy to share some of that.
Get to that in a minute. I think what's interesting about your film is that the dead are the main character. It feels like. And so to not show them, you'll see this perhaps when you see it and have your own opinion, but it feels like to not show them and to blur them would have been so odd in a way that you might stop and it would have taken away some of the impact. I think it would have been to say, we're embarrassed. We can't look at you because you're dead and because this has happened. We as an audience are unable to do that. And so
I'd like to, you know, I will get to that because I think this is an interesting question of if a broadcaster, and it would be a broadcaster more than a festival, but I suppose a festival, I did have a festival ask me, you know, sort of imply that they might accept the film if I would consider having less images of the dead in the film. But yeah, I think that's a certainly an interesting question in the context of my film that's called The Undocumented, right. You know, mm-hmm. which is very kind of intentional that I'm trying to document and give them a face, give them a name.
Now, in remote area medical, the main characters are the people coming in. And so perhaps in the same way, those extractions, I mean, you know, the poverty is seen in teeth. You know, that we you can see a person, you can see their teeth, and you can have a sense sometimes of that. So did you have anyone say, take that out? Or did you think about, in terms of where it would play afterwards, what were your thoughts about that?
We actually never thought will festivals not want to program this? Like, it was less of a kind of business conversation in that way. But just, again, like the line between creating a discomfort that people should have. I mean, you should feel uncomfortable that this is what people have to go through. Mm-hmm. And people are uncomfortable with dental in general, just, you know, even if it wasn't in such a bad situation. But I think part of what makes the extraction so difficult for a lot of people is you see the quality of the teeth. It's like digging out these nubs out of people's mouths. And again, like that says so much about that person's situation. People commented on how in the film there's like this line between someone who has a full set of teeth and somebody who doesn't, or somebody who has very damaged teeth. We did, as I said, have a lot of conversations about how individual people responded to it. And I think the balance that we came up with was that you do see the extractions, but we would show other parts of the body or other parts of the room, like Martha was talking about. And I actually was very pleased with that, because you just like watching someone's hand tense up, like watching what you go through, it is a full body experience, and it doesn't have to be in the mouth the entire time to have that impact.
In just a few minutes, we're going to go and ask you guys for questions, so be thinking about those, but we're going to continue this conversation for just a few more minutes. One more question. This was not a scene with a hard-to-watch extraction, but there is a scene in your film which I found the woman who is the reveal of what that she has a disease.
Oh, yeah.
You haven't seen the film, and I don't want to give too much away, but there is a scene where a woman goes in, and she's another very poor woman who's come out to have this medical care. And it's horrifying that she's in a trailer, and she learns that she has she could have a fatal disease. And I thought, even though that's not an extraction, it's not a body, mm-hmm. It is a scene as a filmmaker that that's pretty undignified for her as a poor woman to have to be on in a film having that.
And it's interesting that you say that, because people in general have a sense of pride, and we talked to a lot of people who had issues with having to go to a free clinic. And I think particularly where we shot in Appalachia, we got this sense from the community of shameful for me to have to go to somebody for help. I've never wanted to ask for help. I was taught to take care of myself and take care of your own, and I can't. And that was really difficult. And we were so grateful that people let us into these intimate moments.
We did
the best we could do, I'd say. From people that we spent any time with, we did talk to them. We didn't feel comfortable just throwing a camera in somebody's face. And as you were saying, these moments of healthcare are incredibly intimate. I mean, the maybe even more so for people who are getting chest x-rays, who are going through these kind of getting huge news, and having somebody film that can't be easy. But we made sure that everyone was comfortable with us being there. And the people who were generally said, well, I want people to know what this is like and what I go through. Like, if this can help somebody, then I want to be able to share that. The scene I actually thought you were going to ask about was there's a scene in which one of the patients that we got to know, he pointed out to us that all these people are going and getting extractions, but that Remote Area Medical, the organization, is not able to give painkillers. And he made a really important point that what do you think people do after this clinic? People go take care of their pain any way they can. And there is a scene in which you see him acquire drugs illegally. And we had a lot of people in test screenings and stuff say that they had an issue with that scene, saying like, oh, I really liked it, except for could you take that out? It just it brings this negative feeling to a film that's otherwise pretty feel good. And that was something we had to.
Well, it kind of brings you to the question, Martha, maybe you can address this. If you're a filmmaker, you have an idea of a film that you want to make, and there's a message there that you really want to help get out. Why hold back on anything? Why make a decision like that not to show something if you really want to show what's happening?
Yeah, I mean, I think with our film, it's an interesting issue because, we're not activists really in this issue. We came at it as filmmakers, and I think that there's a lot of choices that people would make differently. You can always, in our film, you meet a series of patients who are there for, sometimes some have fetal anomalies, some just couldn't get the money together to get an abortion earlier, but it's a range of reasons. And I think, some filmmakers would just say, let's put in only the most sympathetic, easy to understand cases, and that way everyone will leave the film feeling like, I'm totally, third trimester abortion rights are so important, this is why. But we wanted to make a film that challenged people. We wanted to make a film that even force pro-choice people to say, well, wow, it's really hard to understand why someone would make this decision. That's not the decision I would make, but you know, what does it mean to be pro-choice? It means that you have to respect the decisions that other people make, even if they're different from your own. So we wanted to be more provocative from the film, and that's why we included some of these more difficult cases. But yeah, I mean, you're constantly making decisions like that, where it's like, well, this scene really complicates things, and it shows that, you know, it shows that it's not such a, you know, people aren't so black and white, but I think it's really important.
Well, I think, it's interesting because in your film, there was a certain point where I was ready to have someone call in and say they just wanted to have this late-term abortion because they just did not want the child, and you do that, and that is a very challenging moment and a really important moment in the film. And you should know that Martha's film, you know, the doctors obviously are threatened, and at Sundance they had to have some pretty severe security for the doctors arriving. So
yeah, no, it's and I think that's one other reason why it does work well to hide that you don't see the patients' faces. In some ways, you know, we didn't think about this going into it, but it does draw more attention. Those faces that you do see, you realize what a courageous act it is just to allow for the doctors and the staff to allow their faces to be seen. So it draws more attention to that, I think.
Marco, have you ever had a film that you've made that you think back now that you realize something you've left out, that having now made The Undocumented and really being bold in your choices?
Well, you know, when I made Two Towns of JASPER, in that film, I mean, James Byrd's murder is horrific. You know, he's dragged behind a pickup truck for 3 miles, and the autopsy photos are profoundly... they're profound.
Graphic.
Yes, and so we consciously elected not to have that, and that was in deference to the Byrd family in particular. So we have a scene, sounds not unlike Martha's in some sense, where you hear that the autopsy photos were shown in court, and you see the family leave the courthouse, and they're kind of, you know, they've collapsed. We had considered simply just having the recitation of the description of the autopsy, which is very a matter of fact, but as you hear it, it becomes more and more heart-wrenching. And I think so for that film, you know, the decision in the end was that nobody was out on the road but Byrd and the three men, and nobody knew what happened, so we would not privy the viewers to something that, you know, nobody else really had insight on. But, you know, I think here what we're kind of in some ways talking about and considering are, at least as filmmakers, and I don't know if the two of you would agree, a set of ethics that that I think that is brought into the course of making a documentary. I don't think there's one size fits all set of ethics, but I think we have to have a set. And, you know, equally in my film, I document a number of men and women who have been apprehended by Border Patrol. Should their faces be blurred? Should their faces be obscured? What rights do they have?
You know, I thought about that in Gideon's Army. I don't know if any of you were there for opening night, but the people going up, and they're found not guilty, and their faces are up, and I mean their decisions.
Well, I was even thinking that you know, clearly there seemed to be an indication in Gideon's Army that there was a certain allowance of a kind of access, because so much of it is shot from behind. So to suggest that the court was not giving permission, or maybe the individuals did not give permission. But, you know, I'll be very frank. I did not ask the individuals who were apprehended and detained whether or not I had, you know, whether or not they would give me permission to use their image.
You sound like you've thought about that afterwards. Do you think that was the right decision?
I thought about it not simply afterwards, but during, and I made a choice, in many ways I would find that I could be challenged for that more than the images of the dead, because, you know, am I violating some aspect of their civil liberties? And so, you know, the easy route in something like this is that I make use of the law. So the law allows for me to film them and utilize their image without fear of litigation. I use the E&O insurance if the insurer allows it. And so that's just to kind of make myself, you know, kind of somewhat vulnerable in this, those are choices I made. So there are a whole bunch of people in my film who don't give full permission to be seen. And of course the dead don't even have, I mean, what's even more complicating is that the dead, they're dead. I mean, I haven't figured out how you get a release from the dead. And that it's not very clear who has a right of custody or a right of, you know, a spouse, perhaps, but it's not clear in that regard. And then just one last thing on this, that because if you think about it, I mean, it really made me think about this, these choices about what do we show and what do we not show. I mean, do you show somebody that is expressing their grief?
Yeah.
You know, are we, you know, is grief something private? Even if somebody has invited you and given you permission to film them, is their grief private? And yet I think that, you know, documentary filmmakers are continually perhaps looking for those moments that show human beings in their, you know, totality, but why not question a documentarian on that kind of depiction? And in that way, I think that, you know, for me, the targeting of the dead and wishing for there to be a retreatment of that, which I have not really discussed, I think has much more to do with perhaps a different set of issues and concerns coming from whether it's festivals or broadcasters.
Well, you're right. The question of ethics is very interesting, because when you walk in the door with a camera, you have the power. And there are a lot of people who don't feel empowered in general to say no.
I don't agree.
To deny. You don't think so?
I actually think that you can walk into a public scenario. So yeah, in the desert, a bunch of men who've been apprehended by Border Patrol feel powerless. They are terrified of what these Border Patrol agents might do. They're not even thinking about, if they are thinking about, I don't want my image to be shown, they're afraid of the Border Patrol. But everybody else, you more or less ask their permission, may I make a film about you? Right away, they get to decide if they want to be in it. You hold the camera up, you ask a question. They can say, no, thank you. I made a film about my search for my father, and I asked my mother for years, or throughout the film, tell me about my father. And at one point, she basically says, I don't want to be filmed. She makes a statement. You know, she empowers herself. She has that right. And I firmly believe this, that those who are in a film choose. They don't even have to answer the question.
But once they've chosen, they say, yes, you can interview me. And then they sit down and you begin asking these questions. The idea of, do you stop filming when someone's in grief? That there is a shift in power where you're filming and they have sort of, they're sort of lost in their thoughts and aren't thinking anymore, and perhaps maybe overshare? I mean,
It's an interesting question that I would like to, you know, make more public, but I would like you to come see the film. So
yeah.
And this
and
way,
Martha,
but
looks like you wanted to add something.
Yeah. Well, yeah, no, I mean, just along those lines, like we started out and, you know, we're sort of first-time filmmakers, and we were trying to get release forms from all the protesters outside the clinic, because you do see the protesters. And we had mixed responses. Some would sign, some wouldn't. But then at some point, it just became difficult enough that we talked to our lawyer about it, and he said, well, you know, they're on public property, and so actually you have the right to film them no matter what, which was really good for us, just because we wanted to be able to, we didn't necessarily want to have a lot of like interactions. We didn't want to interview them. We just wanted to sort of show the landscape of the film. But a lot of them would get really upset and would feel like their rights were being violated and would want to either be interviewed and be able to explain exactly what they wanted, or just won't want to be on camera at all. And, you know, I think ultimately our feeling was that, you know, you're standing in a public place, you're making a public statement of how you feel politically, and if that we have the right to tell this story. I mean, I think, you know, without that, there's a lot of difficult stories that you wouldn't be able to tell. So,
Absolutely. You want to make a comment, and then let's take a couple of questions.
I was just going to say, one of the challenges that we had is we were going into a region and a community who are used to a specific depiction and a very stereotyped depiction of Appalachia, and you know, sometimes that was really an issue for people. And the first question we get is, what news channel is this on? In a suspicious way, like, what? Because, you know, these people felt like, I know what this 5-minute segment is going to look like. You're going to say, a mass of poor people gathered at this, you know, it's very dehumanizing, that experience. And once we said, you know, we're just making this independent documentary, they're like, oh, okay, that's interesting. And also the gentleman I was talking about who, you know, talked to us about having to purchase drugs illegally afterwards, we did a follow-up interview with him at his home, and his mother was really disturbed by the presence of cameras being there. She eventually told us to leave, and he said, I'm sorry, she thinks the only reason you'd want to talk to me is to make fun of rednecks. Wow. That she was so convinced that that's why people would be interested in his story.
That's interesting, because your film actually does the opposite. It really is quite dignified, I think. Questions? Yes. You know, let me. You can repeat the question. Yeah. I was reminded that if you repeat the question when we receive it, that would be great.
I didn't quite hear the question.
Are you at a university now? You're an associate professor. Are you a professor?
I have to speak to my attorney whether or not I should answer that question. Yes, I am a professor at New York University.
You know what, can I interrupt you and have you come up and use this microphone? Because I think they really do need to hear this question, so I think that's probably the best answer.
Yeah. As somebody who does film work at a university setting, you have a whole other standard, which is the Institutional Review Board, which says you can't film vulnerable populations even if they are in a public setting, and you have to get permission, and you have to do these things because they're afraid of their own lawsuits. And doctors, when we do filming of doctor-patient interaction, doctors are afraid we'll film something that can get them sued. And the university doesn't want to be sued. So I'm wondering, how do you, since you said you didn't get permission, and a lot of your, those of you who aren't in the university may not have this kind of issue, but when you are working in a university setting, how do you deal with the Institutional Review Board and them allowing you to do this under the auspices of being a professor and having these other standards you have to meet, or otherwise being in violation of the contract?
For me, the answer is that I'm not making my films under the auspices of the university, and in fact, I periodically, think about certain university grants, and the minute that if I were to take one of those grants, then I would be under the auspices of the university. So I have not, that has not come up for me, and maybe it's because I'm an associate arts professor in filmmaking, and this is the expectation of what a professor does, but it's not come up for me. So I think you're absolutely right that would be another level, and there would be a whole other set of attorneys' eyes on the examining it and trying to make a determination of whether or not I can do what I've intended to do.
You never go through IRB?
No. You want to come work at NYU? No, I mean, I really haven't, and now that you've raised this and it's being recorded, I knew that I should have listened listened to my attorney here and not answered that question, because I've probably now got myself into very hot water.
Any other questions right now?
Yeah.
Do you feel comfortable coming up and using the mic, or you want us to repeat it for you? Either way is fine, I think. Question is, how much do you go into the backstories of the characters who are primary in the films?
In my film, I sort of, the way I constructed the film is that the dead become the living, you know, kind of in backwards. So we meet these individuals at the point of death. And although it's not fully explicit in the final film, I returned to Mexico with, I think it was 4 coffins, and I don't mean I was riding shotgun with the coffins, but I arrived and met families at the point that a loved one was returned. And I used that construct to kind of bring that person to life at the point of their arrival home. More broadly, because of these individual stories, we get some insights into what the stories might be of others. I'm at once, and you know, you would be the judge if you were to watch the film, trying to present to you the larger phenomenon of the number of people who are dying, but also presenting you with very, very individual stories, because again, I was trying to humanize and not simply have the people be statistics. And while we don't fully know everything about the person who's died, you get some insight from them, and you certainly get a sense of who they were and what they meant to those who are still living.
We also had to try and find this balance between breadth and depth, because sometimes in a very literal way, because there are 2,000 patients coming to this clinic. We want you to understand that they do such a wide range of things, and there's a wide range of problems, and at the same time make sure that you see each person as a person as opposed to just another number. And so we had sort of a mix where there are patients that you just see for a moment, you see them getting their treatment, we don't necessarily interview them, and then there are a few people who we do get into further detail with. And I actually just realized at this moment that the scenes where you do see dental extractions and more graphic dental imagery, it's usually all people that you do get to know. And so you don't just sort of turn away and think that's just somebody getting dental work done. It's, I know this person now, and they're going through this process. So that was something that we did almost unintentionally.
Martha?
Yeah, I mean, similarly, with our film, it's really more focused on the doctor. So you get a lot of information on their backstories and their histories. But with the patients, you don't really, we didn't do any interviews with the patients. We just were capturing their interactions specifically with the doctors or with counselors. But I think, you only see, when you see a doctor with a patient, like in the operating room, actually, it's only patients where we have heard their voice and we know something about their story. So similarly, I think it could be quite like sort of jarring and dehumanizing to see someone who you didn't hear, to see someone in an operating room or, undergoing a medical procedure when you haven't heard their voice at all. That seems like that would be strange.
Yes. Can you come up and you? I know that you don't mind.
All three of you have made films that are hot and heavy in the news: healthcare, immigration, abortion. Did the news propel you to choose those as stories? And what do you think, given where the current dialogue is on these subjects, will it mean in terms of the graphic, explicit, unvarnished way you all show things in your respective films?
Thank you. And also, let me add perhaps maybe what was not being shown on the news that you felt like in an independent film you could take one step further and show, which stays with our topic as well. You want to start with this one?
Sure. I guess the news, the way in which healthcare is talked about on the news was a factor in the sense that my co-director and I had started to discuss this strangeness of how insurance is discussed as a numbers game, but we did not necessarily think we wanted to make a film about it until we volunteered at a remote area medical clinic. And it was just this moment where I felt like I understand the heart of what the healthcare crisis is in a way that I never did on the news. So that was a reference point, but not necessarily what propelled us to make the film.
Martha?
Yeah, for us, it was actually, the film was my co-director's idea, and it actually came to her when she was watching the coverage of Dr. Tiller's assassination. I don't know if you guys saw, but it just couldn't go really into depth about who he was or what motivated him to keep working, because he had actually been shot before. He had endured, you know, decades of protests at his clinics, and he was shot in church. So it just, you know, let us start thinking, first of all, it's so strange that this man who's an abortion doctor, totally vilified by most of the Christian right, also happens to be a very religious Christian himself. And then just, yeah, what would motivate you to keep doing work every day when you know your life is in danger? And we just realized that with the format of news where you have to, they had to sort of have a talking point from a pro-choice person and then a talking point from an anti-abortion person and go back and forth, and you can really go into much depth. So that was, that's sort of where the idea came from that lack. And also I think one thing, just like, you know, thinking about the difference between print journalists or television news journalists and what we're doing, you know, we have a lot more freedom in that way. And with the patients, you know, I just think about like a New York Times article, we're able to preserve the anonymity of all the patients. And you could never do that in a New York Times. It wouldn't meet their ethical guidelines, and it just wouldn't be allowed. So there's just a lot of things that we can do that I don't think you can do in other mediums.
And I think people think they know the story of these doctors, but you really don't. I think your film really shows a side of the patients and the doctors that is not seen. Marco, your film, perhaps more than any other, is a topic that we hear so much about, but yet your film is unforgettable in how it approaches it. So how would you answer that question?
Well, it's interesting. Right now we're hearing a great deal about immigration, but I would say that, you know, it cycles through the news media broadly, right? Immigration reform, Dream Act, varying facets of the immigration situation in our country. But I would say to you, rarely are the deaths highlighted. I would say maybe once every year or so there might be a New York Times article that sort of touches upon it, and they have images of skulls, and then it goes away. And I think that if I have a wish, you know, in making this film, is that migrant deaths become part of the conversation, because I think of the deaths are kind of the ground zero of this. This is the true consequence of immigration. So was I propelled by the topic? Yes, when I started thinking about immigration, and I was thinking about lots of stories on immigration, I was struck by what I, you know, for me, immigration felt like the civil rights battle of the early 21st century. It's very interesting to me that gay marriage has become referred to as gay rights, been referred to as the civil rights of the 21st century, but I think of immigration as certainly being in that same vein, so I was drawn to that for that reason.
Well, anyone else who makes a film about that topic, who makes an independent film at this point, and they decide not to show those bodies, I think you've sort of set an interesting bar for future filmmakers making a film about that particular subject. Question? So the question again is about broadcasting, airing this, and so, Marco.
I probably really should not answer this question, because this is the one that's going to get me in lots of hot water. I have been in a very protracted back and forth with the broadcaster of this film, which is PBS, on whether or not the images of the dead were how they would be presented in the film. And it's been protracted. It's been over 6 months of back and forth where they, you know, I would get remarks like, well, it's really graphic. Okay. You know, and then finally it became, we think there are too many images of dead people. I listened to that. I cut out a whole sequence that's actually different than what I submitted to even full frame, and now what's being shown. There was a whole montage sequence. But it kept every step of the way. They said that they have a community decency standard or community standards on whether or not the dead can be shown. And this has been quite frustrating because I offered comments that, but we never say this about films about the Holocaust, right? There's a community that is very insistent that, you know, we shall never forget. I've seen films about Rwanda, and you see decapitated heads. And so why am I being asked to modify, and eventually I use the words, why are you censoring me and not allowing the TV viewer to be the censor? They can turn the channel. They can turn their head. And it's been an interesting journey because I was, you know, I took certain images out, and then they said no, and then I did a kind of blurring, very gently blurred, and they said no, you have to blur more, and then I got really agitated, and I made a very graphic blur of a dot matrix, black dots all over the body so that the viewer would understand that there was a dead body there, but it was blurred, and they came back and said, oh, we hate that. They look like zombies. You know, they look like they're burnt. God damn it, yeah, I was trying to make people aware. I was making an artistic statement. Then I was told, well, you have to blur it so that you can't even tell that their body's there. And I wanted to say, you know, do you know that I filmed in a morgue? Their body's in the morgue. Well, it's been a long journey, and now after much sort of outrage on my part, they've kind of yielded. And so now the broadcast version is going to be slightly, there are only a couple of images that they've deemed to be so horrific. And in my view, they're, you know, that's what I haven't really talked about, is that the notion that the broadcaster gets to decide what is appropriate for their audience. And there is that's a reasonable factor, but PBS is not exactly a broadcaster that is dependent on commercials. So it's not like it's an offense to they're gonna lose, you know, commercials. So it's troubling that, you know, this broadcaster is called public television would, you know, make these sorts of decisions. I am happy to say that it's sort of been redressed somewhat, but it is an interesting question, and really kind of coming back to choices that we've tried to make here is that I think that we're all sort of responsible and thoughtful and think about certain kinds of choices to create impact for our films. So it's been it's on something called Independent Lens. I mean, if I tell you this, then you're not going to come this afternoon, but it's going to be on Independent Lens on April 29th, and you have to check your local listings.
And you wanted to add something?
Well, I think people have a much harder time seeing the kinds of things that you included in your film when it's happening now. Because the examples that you mentioned, even the Rwandan genocide, you know, that kind of imagery was being shown maybe 10 years later, and the Holocaust, it's part of history. I think it's easier to distance yourself from something that feels past as opposed to something that's occurring and still an issue and still happening all the time.
I suspect, but it's like, why should, I mean, they get to decide because they're saying this is not good for our audience, but, you know, it seemed to me that I received permissions from people to do this, and even, you know, I hope some of you will come today because there are a couple people who are in my film who've journeyed here to be part of the Q&A, and I think they will have some very, you know, interesting things to share in terms of their thoughts on what we are talking about. And, you know, so I made the film, but they are also they are participants. They are active in this narrative, and I think that's a, you know, they might have some interesting reflections and ones that might even challenge what I've set out to do.
Have either any of you ever been offended by something that you have seen that you felt a filmmaker went too far?
I'm going to, you know, it's so remarkable to me how, you know, I saw Nina Davenport's film the other day, which I think is spectacular. It's a tour de force. we all, you know, we don't have a problem with that baby's head crowning through that vagina. It's like, wow, you know, okay, but this is natural. This is life, you know. Well, you know, death is life. You know, it's all, so you know, but I make the choice. I'm squeamish. When I see shit like that, I turn away. I mean, I censor. I go like this, and then I go back. So I think that we have the opportunity to choose whether to look or not look, whether to be seen or not seen.
I can't think of an example. I do think it's context dependent. So there are times when I personally, I'm not offended by difficult material in general, but if it's used in a way that feels inappropriate or the person in the film doesn't actually appear to be okay with it, or, I mean, those things are troublesome.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, this is an interesting issue, like, with abortion, of course, because, you know, there's another film about abortion called Lake of Fire, which shows the entire medical procedure, and you see...
Screened that here a few years ago.
Oh, really? Yeah, I mean, it's a really great film. It's an amazing film, and you do see a photo, you know, a shot of a fetus after the abortion has been performed, and we wanted to make a film that was more focused on the doctors and less on the abortion issue, and we felt like obviously that had been done, but you know, I think it's all contextual. I didn't find it to be offensive in any way in that film, and. Yeah, it just depends whether you feel like, I think generally what bothers me more in films is issues of access, you know, is the filmmaker really allowing these people to speak, or does it feel like it's being manipulated in some way? But yeah.
I assess differently based on whether it's a narrative or a documentary film. And I do, I love both, but in a narrative film, you know that this person is creating this scenario, so the type of choice is different. And in a documentary, that is, it's there. It's, you know, this thing exists, and it's a question of how much to show or whether it's necessary to, you know, make people feel in that particular film.
It's interesting you should say that, because one of the options that I was sort of implicitly given is that if these were actors, mm-hmm. I could show them as dead, as the dead. You know, really?
And certainly all the crime shows on television, the things that broadcasters will show when it's fiction. You know, it's interesting to think that we're discussing here things that are real, that are really happening. We have about 3 more minutes, so let's take one final question. Thank you. So let's see if I can paraphrase that. So when you're making the films, how do you leave your biases at the door so that you can make the film as true as possible?
I don't.
Yeah, I would say I don't think that's possible.
Is that what you're saying?
I mean, I just think that, you know, there's so many different films that could be made out of the footage that we had. You know, we shot 275 hours and... we made the film that we wanted to make with specific goals. You can't just tell. I don't think there's any such thing as just telling the story that happened. I mean, there's always some, you know, some choices you're making that affect the audience's experience.
One thing we did think about in terms of not, I don't know if I'd call it bias, but it's sort of in that realm, the likability of a person in the film, which there are people who appeared in remote area medical who, when we test screened, people would say, like, I don't really like them. And I said, well, that's what makes it complicated, because not everybody's a wonderful person. That's not why they deserve health care.
I just think that, I mean, your question asks and sort of imagines that there's an objectivity, and there really is not one, and, you know, just very explicitly, you make a decision who to cast in your film, right? Who you're going to speak to. You make a decision of when to turn the camera on, when to turn it off. If you're interviewing, what questions you're asking. So biases are already there. Sure, you can make a decision to have multiple sides of a conversation included, And then when you get to the editing room, as you've observed, we have lots of hours, certain choices are being made, and I think there's the fidelity is to kind of a sense of what happened, the truth of what happened, an actuality, but in the end, we're all making very subjective films. So if I gave you my footage and you were to edit it, you'd probably edit it in a way that made sense to you, to a sense of story, let's say, to a sense of certain ideas that you wanted to get across because you felt that that was critical for the larger conversation. So I think bias is inherent in this work because individuals are making it.
So the nice thing to know is that this conversation does not have to end. The great thing about full frame is that when they leave, you guys can catch them in the hallway, out in the plaza, and continue asking your questions. So thank you so much for being here, and thank you to Deirdre and to Molly for making this wonderful venue possible. Please tell your friends to come back to the Speakeasy because these kinds of conversations make this festival wonderful. Let me make sure you know when their films are screening, though. After Tiller, we'll be in Cinema 4 at 7:20 this evening. Remote Area Medical will be in Cinema 1 at 4:30, and in Cinema 3, The Undocumented at 4:10. Thank you all so much for being here.
Thank you, Robin.
Thank you. Thank you.